So we started talking about Planck's law in the last video, and I introduced this formula, which is the Planck's formula, which relates this spectral irradiance, and it expresses that as a function of either the frequency or the function of the wavelength. And in both cases, it's dependent upon the temperature of the black body, which features in this exponential term over here. So what I want to do in this video is to give you a simple derivation of this Planck's law. And turns out, you know, you don't need too much of, it's not a very detailed derivation. With very simple equations, you can derive this Planck's law. So let's see, you know, what kind of equations and math do I need. So the very first equation which I can write down thanks to Albert Einstein is that the energy of my photon is related to the frequency of the light by this formula, where this energy is proportional to the frequency and this proportionality factor is the Planck's constant. So this is the first equation. The second equation I can write is that the momentum of the photon is also given by this relationship, where it's proportional to the wave vector, and I can write the wave vector in terms of the frequency as well. So this wave vector can be written as a function of frequency like this as well. So and the third equation, the only, you know, I need only three equations, and the third equation I can write down is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, that is the uncertainty in this momentum multiplied by the uncertainty in the space, in the real space, has to be greater than, again, the Planck constant. And you can see that the Planck constant is featuring in all the three equations that I need for my Planck's law. So now what I can consider is I can consider this black body, which is in the form of this cavity over here, which has the dimensions of Lx in the x direction and Ly in the y direction and Lz in the z direction. So now I can rewrite this this Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and I can rewrite it for a three-dimensional case in which I'll have essentially something like this: three uncertainty in x, y, and z multiplied by the uncertainty in location in x, y, z, and now this has to be greater than h cube. So now if I have a black body which has this cavity of this particular dimension, I know that the photon is essentially it's localized, you know, somewhere in the cavity, but I don't know its exact position. So in this case, the uncertainty in the position has to be Lx, Ly, and Lz. If that is the case, the uncertainty in the momentum, according to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, it would be essentially given by the minimum would be given by essentially h cubed divided by this Lx, Ly, and Lz. Also, I know that this Lx multiplied by Ly multiplied by Lz is the volume of this cavity of this black body that I had assumed. So I can further express this in terms of the volume of the cavity by this formula. So now what this equation is telling me is that for each of these states which is possible in the momentum space, so let me draw my momentum space. So I'll have, this is my three-dimensional momentum space. So this is my let's say px, this is my py, and this is my pz. So what this equation is telling me is now that each of these solution occupies this delta px amount of space here, delta py amount of space here, delta pz amount of space over here. So each of these solution I can represent by this cuboid over here, where essentially the volume of this cuboid, which is p delta px times delta py times delta pz, is essentially given by this relationship. So essentially each of this cuboid has this particular volume. So now if I think of how many possible, if I have a certain volume in my momentum space, so I can represent this volume by a form of a sphere. So how many of these solutions can be contained in that sphere? So now how many states of photons do I have within this spherical volume? So the total number of photons that I can have, I can write them down essentially as this volume of this sphere in the momentum space. So the volume of that sphere would be 4 by 3 multiplied by pi into the cube of the radius of this sphere. And then the total number of states which could be contained in here is essentially this volume divided by the volume which is occupied by each of the states. So this is essentially divided by this. And to calculate the number of photons, I need to multiply it with a degeneracy factor. That is for each of these states, how many of photons can be occupied in that particular state. So for photons, the degeneracy factor is 2. So if you have any one state, you can occupy 2 photons in that particular state because you have 2 perpendicular polarization of light. So you have two of these particular photons which can occupy each of these states. So I can take the volume in this equation on the left hand side, and I get essentially the total number of photons in this volume of the cavity. I get it, and I substitute for the degeneracy factor to be 2. So I get this formula to be 8 pi into P cube divided by 3 h cube coming from over here. So now this is distributed across all the solid angles. So if I want to find this number of photons in a given solid angle, I could divide it by the total solid angle, which is 4 pi. So I need to divide this by 4 pi, and that gives me the number of photons per unit of my solid angle. And so essentially I'm left with 2p cube divided by 3h cube. Now I can further substitute for momentum. I know that my momentum in my photon, I can express this by this formula because my momentum is related to my wave vector by using this particular relationship that I mentioned earlier as well, which was one of our three starting equations. So I can substitute for the photon momentum as a function of frequency using this relationship. So what I get now is I get h cube multiplied by frequency cube divided by h cube divided by speed of light cube. So these h cancel out, and I essentially get this relationship where my density of my photons as a function of frequency is just simply related by this relationship. So now I know the total number of photons at a particular frequency per unit angle is given by this relationship. So now how many photons are contained between say a frequency h mu, between say a frequency mu and mu plus delta mu. So what is the density of these photons? So that would be given by a simple derivative of this. So I'll take a derivative of that in terms of frequency. So it will be essentially given by a derivative of this relationship with respect to frequency. So I see that I have a third power over here. So when I take a derivative, I'll get 3 times mu square, and that will cancel out with this 3 over here. So this density of these photons as a function of frequency is essentially given by this formula. So now how many of Now, I know my density of photons as a function of frequency. So now I can write down what is the power contained in these by these photons as a function, or what is the power contained as a function of frequency. So I can write down my spectral irradiance as a function of frequency and temperature. So I expect that to be essentially given by this density that I've derived over here, multiplied by the probability that a photon at that frequency is, or that that particular state is occupied with a photon, and I'll multiply this by the energy of the photon, which again is given by this relationship, which was one of our starting equations. So now, the probability is essentially, since photon is given by this Bose-Einstein relationship, which relates essentially the probability of occupation of a photon using this formula, where mu is my frequency, and this other term over here, this is the chemical potential, and this is zero for photons and in general thermal radiation. So my probability is essentially just simply as a function of my frequency is just given by this relationship. So now I have all the ingredients together. Let me substitute for this probability over here, and then I'll substitute for this density of photons from this formula, and that should give me essentially my formula for my Planck's law. So let's see, what do I get? So I get essentially 2 square of my frequency term over here, and then I get this exponential term over here, and then I multiply it by this energy of my individual photon. So I get essentially, instead of getting 2 over here, I get finally this term over here, and this is my Planck's relationship.